All right. So how do we represent all of these different things in a file? Because we're going to need to do data analysis with this, which means the computer has to be able to store this information. So one way you could think about it is, so this is given two individuals, Rob and a mystery person. We could write the reference SNP and the alternate SNP, the chromosome and the position, and then we could write for each individual what haplotype has what, right? So remember, each person has two versions of a chromosome, which we can call their haplotype. So for this one, we've written individual one, which is Rob, has a C for haplotype one and a T for haplotype two. This depends on you having phased genotypes, though. So that can be problematic for reasons that we talked about before. So here's another way of writing it. Again, this still requires you to have phased genotypes, but computers don't like letters. So the more that we can condense things into zeros and ones, which is what your computer speaks at the very basic level, the better. So this is normally how it's written in files. So you have a line that tells you what the reference and the alternate is, but then for each of these individuals, you don't bother writing it out again. So you assign the reference a zero, and then if they have the alternate, it's a one. Does that make sense? So this is like a binary categorization. Yes?
Are ATCG also stored as maybe two-bit data structures instead of characters?
Like on the basic level, yes. So these ones will be encoded like that in a binary file, but you don't have to worry about that.
So it's not your typical ASCII character.
So usually, yeah. So for a lot of these analysis types, you will have a binary file, but you can decompress it and it will be formatted as an ASCII character. Does that make sense? Don't worry too much about how we do compression and stuff like that. Because you probably won't be dealing with that part of it. If you are, you'll be told about it. yeah. So when I have a zero here, what does that mean?
Reference.
And when I have a one, what does that mean? So individual two, what do they have at the first position?
Two.
For both haplotypes? Yeah.
Yeah.
So that means that they are homozygous for the alternate allele. Make sense? Okay. So again, this requires you to have phased chromosomes, which can be problematic. So another way that we, and this is called a haplotype matrix for obvious reasons, this part, because we've got the haplotypes and then we have the genotypes for each one of these haplotypes for each individual. Another way that's really common, this is more what I usually deal with, is called the genotype matrix. So again, that's just this part is called the genotype matrix. So instead of being two columns for each individual, we now have one column for each individual. And instead of caring what haplotype, which allele is on, we just do a count. So this count is of how many instances of the alternate allele we see. Does that make sense? So in individual one, we see one instance of the alternate allele. In individual two, if you remember what there was, we see, oh, I think I've got backwards who is who. So apparently Rob is individual two. Oh, no, it's this one. Excuse me, confusion. Yeah, so for the first variant, individual two is homozygous for the alternate allele, which means they get a count of two. That makes sense? I feel like I kind of slotted that a little, but that's a much more compressed way to write it. And you can, this can actually deal with multi-allelic. Actually, you wouldn't need that because it's always going to be 0, 1, or 2, so forget I said that.